Hey folks, it's Glenn with the Cactus Atlas, and today I'm going to be visiting Pipe Spring National Monument, one of Arizona's least visited national monuments. Let's go check it out. So about that seldom visited thing here, I did read that as true, but there's actually a pretty healthy amount of folks visiting here on Labor Day weekend 2022. I'm going to give you a little look at this terrain here in the Arizona Strip. We're not far from Kanab, Utah. We're actually even closer to a place called Colorado City, which I might do a quick casual drive through there after we're done here today to round things out. Some of you have probably heard of Colorado City, but very beautiful country here. So what I think we're going to be looking at today once we enter the visitor center is an old fort, old Mormon fort from the 1800s when pioneers were settling this area, citing manifest destiny as their justification for just plowing through. So anyway, I'm really excited to see this piece of Old West history. So let's get into that visitor center and hopefully they have AC. And there's grass, something I don't see often. I have high hopes for this now. And I'm going to be honest with you, probably about a half an hour ago, didn't even know this really existed. So I saw a sign, looked it up on the internet and said, boom, that's what we're doing. So I think this, I don't know if this is all focused on the Mormon history or what, or the Paiute Indians. So we're going to learn a little today. So let's go start in the visitor center, which is always the proper place to start. The visitor center here was well done and I took my time and learned everything that I could actually. So the story that we're going to be exploring today is really the story of several entities: the Mormons, the Native Kaibab Paiute Indians, and the U.S. federal government. This is where all of these things clashed in the movement towards the West known as Manifest Destiny. In the visitor center, if you watch the movie, you'll really learn a lot about the Kaibab Paiutes who lived in this area. And when the Mormon settlers started coming into this area, they would bring lots of cattle, cows that were not native to this area, that just tore up and ate all of the natural plants and grasses that the natives depended on for things like seeds to eat. So that was one of the first things that really started to disrupt the natives' lives in this area. I do have to remark too at how beautiful the grounds are here. This is a really old looking wagon. No information about it, but looks from the period. So the main fort and all of the relics from that time are located behind the visitor center. So you have to walk a little ways. Talk into the ranger in the visitor center. There's a half a mile hike. It's really short that we'll go up on those red rocks, giving us a really good view of the Arizona Strip. So I plan on doing all of it. And there is a tour of the fort every 30 minutes, I think. And it is guided, so we'll see. I don't know if I can film in there or not. We'll see how it goes. This is a really interesting exhibit here showing you how the Paiutes lived. These are known as cons, I think, if I read that correctly, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. So when the Mormons came out here, obviously those civilizations had a much different way of life, were very resource hungry, and you know, you could see in the background, that's the world that the Mormons came from, and this is the world of the Kaibab Paiute. A big story about Manifest Destiny, and specifically the Mormons, just like the video in there says, they believed natives like the Kaibab Paiute were uncivilized and it was their duty to civilize them, to bring them religion and to teach them their ways. And this really caused a lot of conflict as the natives really didn't understand that way of life, nor were they really interested in that. Looks like we want to go that way for the fort tours, which I'm going to save that towards the end if that is still available to do. Should be, I would think. And we'll do our self-guided tour first. I think I'm going to check out this garden back here and all that, those fences, and see what this is all about. There are wagons galore to be found back here. I'd assume relics of the times that we're exploring today. No signs though that explain it, so couldn't be 100% sure, but it's still cool. Wonder why they're growing what appears to be gypsum weed all over the place here. I think that's what that is. Psychedelic plant. Let's see, it looks like there's a gate. It says welcome, so I assume we're allowed in here. This was improved due to our fee dollars, so cool, my National Parks Pass helped pay for some of this. This is a beautiful garden. I don't know if they're trying to recreate a period garden or if this is just something, but you could see they even have pumpkins. I know someone that loves their pumpkins. It's getting to be close to that time. But yeah, just sunflowers. Very beautiful. Very peaceful. Pretty much any vegetable you can think of you're gonna find a sign for. Not everything's in season, of course, but this is pretty neat. I enjoyed this little stroll through this garden. It's pretty. And right there you get a really nice view of the old fort up on the hill. This appears to be some kind of corral or something like that. I don't know if we can go in there or not, but if the people had all this cattle back then, this is probably, oh my goodness, what it would have been like. And there you go. There's the culprit right there. That is a big boy. I don't think I've ever seen a cow like that or a bull with horns that big, like in person up close before. A longhorn. It's a very formidable looking beast. I would not want to mess with that. The next thing I want to show you right over here is the reason why they had to build a fort here, why they felt they had to build a fort here. Pipe Spring. You all have been on enough adventures here on the Cactus Atlas to know the desert is a dry place and water is a rarity to find in nature, but here at Pipe Spring, there's all the water you can drink in this natural spring that was here before the Mormons even settled the area. I'm almost amazed to see it myself. The water's crystal clear when there's not like scum on top of it. But this is how all those thirsty cows were able to survive out here. And yeah, they needed a lot of water and resources. The video I watched in the visitor center talks about these springs a lot because this is the centerpiece here and the essential thing the Mormons needed to settle the area and to bring more cattle into the area. But it was interesting to kind of contrast the Paiute's view of resources like water with that of those coming from the east, heading out west like the Mormons. The Paiutes had a very special relationship with nature, and they would do things like talk to the water and tell it what it was going to be used for. They had great respect for it, and they even had a name for these springs. Like, I don't remember it, I couldn't pronounce it probably if I wanted to, but when the Mormons came here, they just kind of took over this area and cut the Paiutes off from this really important water source, and the Paiutes actually had to leave the area because of it. So enter this fort. This fort, called Windsor Castle, was built here really just as a show of force and also certainly as a way to protect this. This is probably more valuable than gold out here, I would have to imagine. Oh, neat. Does the spring run under the house too? You could see running water here. It's saying don't touch any of the stuff because it's poisonous algae apparently, but dragonflies are blue, maybe because they drink that freaky algae. I don't know. But it's weird because I think this is the spring. I think it just flows here and then comes out over here where we saw earlier out into this cistern. The signs over here talk about how in Mormon society back in the 1800s, tithings were oftentimes paid for with cattle and steer. So that's why this was such an important area. I'm telling you, this was a big business, and you can see there's old pictures just showing, like, you know, what this would have been like. You would have had thousands of cows roaming. It said every day 800 to 100 cows had to be milked on this ranch between 1870 and 1877. So apparently that would equate to, reading the sign, about 60 pounds of cheese and 40 pounds of butter. So I assume per day is what that would mean. Wow, that's a lot if that's true. So there's a plaque here commemorating Windsor Castle and Mr. Windsor, the original guy in 1863 that settled this area for the Mormons. And then eventually this fort was constructed. Whitmore was killed by Indians actually about 4 miles away from here. So he was here in the very earliest times, but didn't last long. And another buggy. Oh cool, there's a building. I think we can go in here. As long as it's cool, that's all I care about. Oh, that scared me. That thing slams hard. This is known as the East Cabin. So I think at one point it was a living quarters for someone. And then between the late 1800s and the early 1920s, the place fell into a state of disrepair and started to deteriorate. And what this is talking about is how they try to recreate and preserve historic buildings using local techniques that would have been accurate to the time. And I think that's what they attempted to do here with the style of construction here, to give you a sense of what this would have been like. Outside in the sun, it's got to be in the low hundreds today easily. And I came in here, I was really hot. My camera keeps overheating. And in here, it's got to be like 10 degrees cooler or something, just being in the shade especially. So if I had to live out here without air conditioning and I was in one of these stone buildings, I think I could get by. All right, so I think the next thing I want to do is actually go into the fort and see if they're doing a tour or if we can just take a peek inside. All right, so I'm now inside the fort, and a couple of cool things to note in here. You can actually see the original wall. They have it kind of framed off here, which is really neat. And what I've seen is the spring flowing right through this room. We were outside, remember? We saw it flowing out. I'll have to ask about that one. So we're inside the fort. And they used to do tours, but they stopped after the pandemic. So it's kind of a self-guided type of thing where you can just go up to doors and poke your head in like so. But when you come in here and you smell that old smell that I always like to talk about. And you can see the big fireplace, the wood floors look original to me. This is a really neat building. Some biscuits over there. I'll sneak over to this one really quick too. And take a look-see here. This is that room connecting here. Oh, this one's really musty. I think you could see the first managers here. I forget their names, but I kind of recognize their picture. I think they were the first that managed this. Wow. This is amazing. And although I think I read not all of these pieces were recovered from here, this is stuff that's been donated and should be accurate to the time period. So you're seeing a room probably as it would have looked back then. I hear the guy talking to some other folks. That spring does run under the house, just like we were surmising in that room. Apparently it's not running as fast as it used to historically. It used to put out 40 to 50 gallons an hour, I think, as we were saying. You could grow a lot with that. But now it's kind of slowed down. I think we're in a drought condition now, but that was indeed the spring. This is where I assume the butter and cheese was produced, the massive quantities that they talk about outside. Probably in that big tub right there. So I would say this was the highlight for me for sure. And it was kind of cool because they're not doing the self-guided tours now and you couldn't really see everything. I think the gentleman was saying this side is very reminiscent of the other bedrooms we saw on the other side. So I don't think we missed much. I think we saw most of the interior. My favorite thing was seeing the spring flowing through the building and the inside must have been really convenient. It's like they had running water. So I read that the fort really didn't have to get used too much for its intended usage, offending off natives in this area, although there were conflicts here and there. But, you know, it served its main purpose, and then in later years it served as a sanctuary for a different purpose. In the late 1800s, the Mormon church officially denounced plural marriages or polygamy, and really put an end to it, kinda. As we all know, that wasn't really truly the end of it, and there were still holdouts that practiced plural marriages. And for those, this place served as a sanctuary. So at one time this was a fort to protect against the natives and hostile people of the area, and then it became a sanctuary for people practicing plural marriage. This looks like a pioneer Conestoga type wagon that these early settlers, including the Mormons, would have been in. There probably would have been kids and stuff back here. Imagine traveling thousands of miles in something like this on a very bumpy surface where these are your tires basically. So this house, which is very similar to the east house right next door, was actually built in 1868 for the Mormon militia that came down to this area because of recent Navajo raids that actually killed Mr. Whitmore, the original founder of this area. Well, not the original founder, that would have been the natives, but I guess for Anglos, the person that really put this place on the map. And it's really interesting to be standing here in an 1868 structure, I assume reconstructed or restored, just like the neighboring building. It's built with the same materials, but nonetheless. This is the roof of the guardhouse and the east house. I didn't even see you can get up here, and look at this, it's covered with mud. That's how they did it, I guess. Must be a mess after a rain and must require a lot of maintenance. All right, so this here is the Ridge Trail, and it climbs to the top of the low cliffs that overlook Windsor Castle, so we can see the fort from above, and the Arizona Strip from the top is spectacular. You sold me, except for the Great Basin rattlesnakes. I don't really need to see that, but I guess it's a loop. One of those hikes that I'd say awesome for the history, but it's still awesome for just the natural beauty. Ah, look at this view of the Arizona Strip. If we can go back 150 years ago and see out here, we may have seen the hunter-gatherer Paiutes roaming around, wagons, thousands of cattle, all in this area. All right, I think we're at the pinnacle of the trail, and this is talking about where we're at in this section called the Arizona Strip. We're really close to Utah, and it's really the area that's cut off by the Colorado River. We've talked about this in other episodes. So right here, the Arizona Strip, and out yonder would be the Colorado, the Grand Canyon, somewhere off that a ways. Well, there you have it, folks. I'm standing in the nice cool shade next to Pipe Spring, sucking it all in one last time before I head on out. Just wanted to come check this place out. So if you're ever in this section of Arizona or in southern Utah even, Kanab, this place is easily accessible. You can see it's quiet, it's peaceful, it's beautiful, and it's filled with Old West history. My favorite. See you next time.